That's all right, we'll give you harassment.
That's right.
It's pick on Cody Day, I think, isn't it? How many of you vote for that? Oh, see, automatic. Anyhow, no, we'll be nice to you. I'll be nice to you.
Good.
Yeah, you're going to sing, aren't you, with your crew here today? So we better be good, or
right. You'll
probably make us dance in the street or something like that.
That's right.
Anyhow, so it's good to be together. I really do look forward to Sunday morning, spending time together. It's good to connect. Boy, a lot happens in a week, doesn't it? A lot goes on. And so it's good to be able to talk, catch up with one another, and enjoy some understanding of how God's at work in our life. The living God, we're just really not into this for religion's sake. Religion is just going through the motions. We're here to meet God. And I always think about that on Sunday morning. You know, sometimes I easily fall into the routine. It's my prayer that you're not here for routine, but you're really here to meet the living God and to enjoy his presence. You can pull out your bulletins if you want. Our fearless leader, our champion of us as a church and where we're going, what we're about, is Wes. He's our moderator. So he's going to tell us a little bit about what's going on. So if you're visiting,
there we go.
Yeah, there we go.
Well, thank you for that. Good morning. If you want to draw your attention to the insert in your bulletin there on the back side, those are the business recommendations we will be taking up next week in our vision and planning meeting. We got five there listed, and the custodian salary and Pastor Sally, will also be a recommendation too. So if you have any questions or thoughts about that, or more information you'd like, you can talk to me, give me a call, or down on the bottom it says Church Board Members. You see them listed there. You can talk to one of them as well, too. They were all in the meeting, and so they know about this TLBC makeover, and they know about the salaries, and so feel free to get more information if you'd like to. So thank you.
One little detail is there's a motion on the finances that are back there in the back with the reports, because people, if you're visiting, that's fine. Pick these up. You want to know what's happening financially or what's going on, you're welcome to pick them up. They're on that little table on your way out. But this is a recommendation for next week as well. One of our goals is that you know what's going to be happening and you know that it's worth your time to come. A lot going on and a lot of important decisions. So this is not for members only. Members can vote, but anybody in the church, or if you're visiting and you're interested in where the church is and where we're going, you're welcome to come to that. It's really vision and planning more than just a business meeting. So business meetings are, we take care of the business. This is where we're going, what we're about, and making decisions for the future. So you're welcome, whoever would like to come to that, to be a part of it. Also, do you know what's happening on October the 5th? Wow! Yeah, that's right. Wow's happening. Yes. Yeah, Wow's starting up. So we have a children's ministry. About 90% of the kids really come from our community, and a lot of you are involved. Now, our requirement is if you attend church here, you have to be involved in Wow and youth ministry on Wednesday night. How you do that is either be here or giving or prayer, but everybody gets involved in Wow because it's so big. So a lot of you do a lot of different things, supporting people, encouraging people, helping spouses to be involved so they can be involved, whatever. And it's amazing. It is really amazing. And today, after the service, we have another event. Anybody know what that's about?
Potato bar.
Food, yeah. So it's a way that we can support our youth in going on a trip, a missions trip next summer. And so if you're visiting here and you didn't bring your cash, please come down anyway and have a time with us in fellowship. But it's also a time when we can support our youth. So while all the details of WOW are coming up, and I have sheets of paper here that are going to be handed out, but if you want to find out about WOW and the kids ministry, we're going to have a barbecue that night to kick off, and I think we're going to have some football fun with football players from town. So we're going to have a little bit of fun with that. So it'll be a good evening. With that. So let's see. What else should I mention today? Anything else I should mention today?
The baby shower for Ethan and Caitlin.
Good. Yep. Yeah, I was going to add that next week, but yeah, it's when? When is it again?
15th.
October 15th. So a couple weeks. Yeah, I don't have the invitation in front of me.
At 2:00 in the Lutheran Church.
Good. Super. Excellent. Steer Missions Conference is coming. Paul Singer is involved with that. And on that, if you don't know what that's about, that's fascinating. It's a great ministry for missions. Also, some of you have asked about November the 9th. Why do we, you know, traditionally we don't have that where we have an emphasis on mission. That really confused me. I didn't grow up on the farm. I was not a farm guy. And they had Mission Harvest Festival. I never got that, what that was about, until they said, well, it's about missions, and it's about harvest is for bringing in the crop, and so that's what that's about. For those of us who are not agricultural background, it's because of the fall season, bringing the harvest, and so it's for missions. So the focus is on mission, and the offering that Sunday goes to missions, so that's what that's about. And Chuck and Claire Klein, they're two of our missionaries, a couple, and so we support them, so they're going to be here and speaking and being a part of that. Also, you'll notice that if you're on food committees, that you've got a couple things coming up in the future in terms of which group that you're a part of. So you might want to make note of that. Good. Also, next Sunday we have Communion Sunday. We have that every other month, so next Sunday is Communion Sunday. I think that takes care of a lot of things. Couple of the week. Did you know you were going to be couple of the week? Yeah, there you are, right there, yeah. I kept Shelby off because he's next week. So if he wonders, how come I wasn't included? He's a grown guy, and so I have his separate week. But really good to pray for you. Good to have you here. You've got a new job, and good to have you here today. You're not able to be here all the time, but it's really good. So we'll get to pray for you this week. Also, in terms of swing bed, Shirley's doing all right. She's adjusting to a new place there, and in Bismarck, so we care about that. We care about those who are in cancer treatment. Carmen had a tough week with some not so good news, so we're praying for extra courage for him, extra strength, and that treatment will go well. And then you'll see our TLB Church Makeover college students, praying for them, and also different workers that we enjoy being involved with. I know different ones of you said, yeah, you want to be involved in this and that and the next thing. That's great. Also, we're praying for people to come to know Christ, so let's pray today. God, we talk about a lot of different things, but ultimately we need you to help us. Activities without your Spirit are just busy work. And God, we don't want to be a busy church. We want to be effective as people in our jobs, school, neighbors, making a difference in our community. So God, we're about that. About learning what it is to walk with you each day, what it is to be in tune with your Spirit, what it is to see you transform the lives around us, our neighbors, the people that we work with. God, I thank you for today and spending time together. You've heard each one of these needs that we have, and each one concerns. We know people, just a few people I've been talking to has had a lot going on this week. People getting ready today for the food. So God, I pray you take care of each one of us and the needs we have. Thank you that you care for Carmen and needs that he has specifically this week of just adjusting to treatment, and just take care of him. Give him inner strength and courage from your Spirit. Thank you for Stanley and Sheila and their faith and their courage. And I know our new job, so just give them strength today. Thank you, God, for the joy of children and youth. And God, even this week, and just seeing all these youth that are coming and trying to figure out how do we provide space for them. God, we thank you for challenges like that we have as a church, because there's so many. We pray for WOW and just arranging leaders and material, and bless Trista as she leads us and give her encouragement. Thank you for all the flyers that are going to go out to the kids here next week. So I pray for that. I even heard of new people coming to youth that are from our community. So God, I pray that you just help children to come to know you as their personal Savior in their youth. I pray today that your Spirit would rest upon us as we sing and proclaim your character and your heart through singing, and as we listen to your word, as the children have children's church, oh God, I pray you'd be honored. Thank you for the sweetness of being together today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we're going to have the ushers to come forward and take the offering. To visitors here, we always say every Sunday is like you're visiting, so keep your wallet in your pocket, because we're just glad to have you here. So relax. Somebody says, well, when do I stop being visitor? And it's like, well, that's a good question. Whenever you feel comfortable, you're not a visitor anymore. So I'm not sure what date that is, but God bless you as you give today.
Good morning, everybody. We're going to start our worship session here, so if you guys could all stand. And as you're standing, I'm going to read out of a psalm today. Sometimes it's good to go back to the Old Testament, even though sometimes we struggle reading it. But hey, it's a good one to remind us about who God is and the things behind it. So I'm just reading out of Psalms. It's Psalm 91, and it's going to be 3 through 9. It says, "For he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and a buckler. You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in darkness, nor the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only look with your eyes and see the recompense of the wicked, because you have made the Lord your dwelling place, the Most High, who is my refuge." And just what we're talking about today is, like, you know what? Just depending upon God and Jesus and leaving it at that, and like just following him each and every single day and having him be the refuge that you go to in everything that you do and being jacked about it. So as we sing these songs today, it's being jacked for Jesus and singing for him. So here we go.
I'm leaving my past behind. I'm setting my heart and mind on you, Jesus. I'm reaching my hands to yours, believing there's so much more, knowing that all you have in store for me is good.
Today is the day. Today.
truth. And all my days I'll live for you. All my days I'll live for you. I will stand upon your truth. I will stand upon your truth. And all my days I'll live for you. All my days I'll live. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I won't worry about tomorrow. I'm giving you my fears and sorrows. Where you lead me, I will follow. I'm trusting in what you say. Today is the day.
Sorry, I got unplugged there. It happens sometimes, right? All right, we're good. Last song here is one we've sang a couple times. It's God of the City. You know, sometimes we get caught up in the little things, or whether it's politics or whatever in life, but we should never forget the main thing, which is God is the God of this city, whether it's Turtle Lake, this building, our country, or the world. And he's gonna, as long as we're leaning into him, that's all we need to do. It's each and every single day. So as we sing this song, just think he's the God of everything for us.
City, you're the king of these people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God.
You know, we look to you and, you know, you are the God of this city. You're the God of everywhere, the God of our two hands and our feet. Whether we like it or not, you direct us because you have the will that's beyond us. And you show us each and every single day that, you know what? One of the best jokes we can say is, here, God, this is my plan. This is my plan. And God goes, no. I have a plan for you. And it's even better than what you thought. So, Father, today, let's just focus on understanding that it's about living for you each and every single day, not dealing with all the side things, getting caught up on all the side things, but focusing on you, not the corruption things that are going on, whatever may be going on in our life, but to focus through you and understand you deeper and lean into you through prayer, getting into your words of life that you give to us. But most importantly, God, to acknowledge you for you who you are, which is through your Son, Jesus Christ, we are saved, and that is an awesome thing to have. So God, let's make this service be an encouragement. And that we can go out of here and break down these barriers in Turtle Lake and have people come to know Christ for you. And not get caught up in the side things, but caught up in you. So Father, we praise you and we really just thank you for your Son. Because without him, we couldn't do anything. And all of God's people said, amen.
I love that song. I just love that song. I'm glad they sang it a few weeks over. You know, the younger generation, they sing a new song every week. It's like, oh man, you know, I can't even get caught up with the last song. But anyhow, I love that song. Thanks for singing a few times. You know, our city and our surrounding area needs Jesus Christ. And we've got such good news like the song talks about. And we have the privilege of sharing it in various ways. So it's really good to be able to enjoy it and to sing about it. And to say, God, we do want you to be God of our city and to be able to pray about it. I mentioned prayer and being a key component of what's going on and what's happening in terms of these days. And we started a special team this year, a little bit different twist with WOW. We're going to actually go around to the different classes and have a prayer time with the different groups. And so if you're interested in being a part of that, we're going to meet about that same time and go around and pray together. So we focus on praying for WOW and for the youth. So if you'd like to be a part of that, it's a great time together. It sort of stretches us because we're not always comfortable with that, but we'd love to have you be a part of that as well. So it's time for children's church. So all the kids can come up. Jill, are you on tap today? Thanks for doing that. I appreciate that. So we've had some fun painting with the good old different colors, right? And in fact, some of you helped paint one week. Were you here the week I had you help paint? Can't remember. Who was here? Were you here? Yeah, we did a lot of painting. And we got the J going. What's the big J represent?
Jesus.
That's right. The big J represents Jesus. And the little J represents?
John the Baptist.
John the Baptist. And then we have these people around here. Anybody remember? That's a little tougher question. All these little...
Disciples.
The disciples, yeah. And we want our initials to put on there as well, that we're a follower of Jesus Christ, and that's why you're going downstairs, isn't it? We're studying the Gospel of John, and Jesus, you know who he got angry with? He got angry with some of his church people because we were hypocrites. We weren't living out what Jesus wanted. So sometimes Jesus has to straighten us out, doesn't he? So we're going to pray that God helps our hearts to be right today, and we're glad that you can go down, and Jill's going to, who's the helper? Yeah, the helper today? Good job, and you're a helper? Good. Thanks for that. I appreciate that. Let's pray. God, I thank you for, you can be the big J in our life, the Jesus who just teaches us and we can follow, help our hearts to be in tune. Thank you for just those who are working with our kids. I pray you bless them today in Children's Church in Jesus' name. Amen. And just have a great time. Thanks for helping. All of us are in a painting. And God is the master painter, and he wants to paint our lives, and he wants to color our lives up, and he wants to be the center. He wants to be the big J, and we need to be the followers. And we have the privilege of being involved with that. And we're all different colors and shapes. I mean, just look around. I mean, some of us look pretty funny, and others of you look really nice. But, you know, there's all different colors and shapes. And God cares about every one of us. And he wants us to be involved in what's going on. Jesus came down, and he changed the world forever. And we have the privilege of being involved in changing the world forever in our life, too, as well. Your little world, God wants to change the people around us forever. And I'm not talking temporary, make the world a better place. I'm talking about eternal life. And the book of John really deals a lot with eternal life. Now, there are people today that say, oh, eternal life, I don't believe in eternal life and all that stuff. It's fascinating. It's like, but every culture, every generation has always thought about eternal things. Like, is there a heaven and a hell? Is there really anything beyond? Every culture has dealt with that. They answer it in different ways. Jesus, too, said, hey, I've got some truth about eternal life, and he wanted to work with that. Now, today we're going to deal with religious corruption. So Jesus didn't get angry about many things, but he got really angry at the church. So today I want all of you to take some money out. You can have a dollar bill, a $5 bill. You got to hold it during the service. You didn't bring your wallet? Okay. Well, you can use my dollar bills or whatever. Got to share your money around. If they didn't bring money, you got to have everybody. I want to have everybody to have a dollar bill out, or $5, $20, or $100, or $1,000, whatever bill you have. Everybody needs to have money out. What's that? Twenties. That's all right.
Got 80 bucks.
$80. Yeah, it's a good day.
I don't want my kid to know how much money I have in my wallet. Now everybody knows how much I have in my wallet. I had 85, actually. out of five, anyhow. Yeah, okay. So money is really sort of uncomfortable thing. It's like, you're really going to talk about money? Yeah, but I'm not going to talk about your money. Well, yes, I am going to talk about your money, because if you give to church, then we're going to talk about church money, which is part of your money. Jesus got very angry about how we handled money as churches. He got so mad that he ran through the temple and he cleaned out people and animals because he was so mad about how we as churches deal with money. You know, there's people that are not in churches today because of how churches we have handled money. They won't attend church. They're angry because how we handled money. And you know what? Their anger is justified. They're right. Now, Jesus didn't abandon church or the synagogue because of money, but he got it straightened out. So today we're going to talk about how do we keep our money focus right, because you got to deal with money. It's just part of life. I mean, there's no way to get around this. You got to deal with money. I mean, we try and say, well, you know, we deal with the credit card, the debit card, or whatever. But you know what the truth is? We deal with this every day. Every age, even children, are always dealing with money. Maybe not their own, but their mom and dad's money. But they're always dealing with money. Are we going to save it? Are we going to spend it? Are we going to invest it? Or what are we going to do with it? Some of us are really good at earning money. Some of us are good at saving money. Some of us are good at spending money. But churches have habits about money and how we handle money. And we can either represent God well, or we can actually destroy what God is about with money. So church and money is a big deal. It's a big deal. But why did God design it that churches had to deal with money? Really, if God would have done away with money, it'd been a lot easier, because then churches wouldn't have anything to do with money. But it always involves finances. Always. I think the reason is because Jesus said, where your money is, where your treasure is, your heart will be also. So Jesus said, how we handle money shows the heart. And I would say, you can take the budget of the church and you can see where the heart of the church is at by looking at the budget. And you can also tell the heart of the church by how people in the church handle church money. I was rather amused this week by people that had invested deeply in the ministry of this church. I don't think, from what I know, it even went in through the church money. But they personally believe in the ministry of the church and have personally invested their own money way beyond what the budget says. It's like, oh. So how we handle money as a church is really critical. And the story today shows how important it is. We saw last week that Jesus did his first miracle at Cana of Galilee, and we talked about that and the miracle of what Jesus did. We got to the end, and it says, thus the first of his miracles, that's chapter 2, verse 11, thus the first of his miraculous signs Jesus performed at Cana of Galilee. He thus revealed his glory, his character, his amazement. He showed it by what he did, the miracle, and his disciples put their faith in him. And ultimately, we're going to come back to that. Ultimately, if we don't keep our focus on people putting their faith in Jesus Christ, then we miss it. We miss it completely. In a lot of churches, that's what happens, and that's where we get off base. So we'll come back to that. We're memorizing a verse which ties into this passage of Scripture that says, these things are written right here, even in chapter 2, the last part of John chapter 2. Have written that we may believe that Jesus is Christ. So the focus is not on money. It's not on church. It's the goal is that people might believe that Jesus is Christ. And today, if you're here and your focus has been on church and whatever, it's like, that's not the goal of a church. I'm sorry that we as churches have got the focus wrong. The focus is that we
together that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ. That word Christ means that Jesus is the Messiah. He's the Son of God. He's divine. And that believing, you may have life in his name. I like that song that we sang about Jesus being the God of the city, because it talks about how they need him because of what Jesus can do for their lives. Yeah. Provide life. And this word life literally implies eternal life that we have in Jesus Christ. We're going to especially see that in John chapter 3, which we come to next week, about why Jesus came and how he wanted to provide eternal life. And the bad news is that if you're living for what you can get out of it down here, eventually your life and your world will crash around you. Jesus says, I want to have eternal life, which is way beyond this lifetime. Now, as we come to chapter 2, verse 12, I want to read these verses. And what I want you to do is I want you to all close your eyes today. And I want you to picture in your mind what's happening. So if everybody can close your... No, that's really dangerous for a pastor to do. You're already probably half asleep. So now I ask you to close your eyes and you're going to probably fall asleep. And Josh is already falling asleep on me. Here we go. I want you to picture in your mind what's happening. So close your eyes if you can, if you feel comfortable. After this, he went down to Capernaum with his mothers and brothers and his disciples. There they stayed for a few days. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple courts, he found men selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords, drove all from the temple area, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins, the money changers, and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, get these out of here. How dare you turn my father's house into a market? His disciples remembered this, that it was written, zeal for your house will consume me. Then the Jews demanded of him, what miraculous sign can you show us to prove you are of authority to do all this? Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and I will raise it up again in 3 days. The Jews replied, ha, it has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you are going to raise it up in 3 days? But the temple he was speaking of was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. Then they believed the scriptures and the words that Jesus had spoken. Now, while he was in Jerusalem at the Passover feast, many people saw the miraculous signs he was doing and believed in his name. But Jesus would not entrust himself to them, for he knew all men. He did not need men's testimony about men, for he knew what was in a man. Let's pray. God, I pray that your words would come alive today in our minds. May your spirit make it live in our church family. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Fascinating story. Jesus getting angry. Anger is a God-given emotion which is healthy if it's handled right, and it's a righteous anger. Now, anger can be very destructive in a marriage or family or in a church or wherever you're at, your business. But anger handled appropriately and done in the right way for the right reasons. I always say you can measure people by what they get angry about. How angry they get and what they get angry about is a fascinating discussion. Why do they get that angry about that thing? It's like, it's a fascinating thing to think about. If you want a really interesting thing, you can... this week you can chart what made you angry, how angry did you get, and then why did you get angry about that? That's a fascinating little study that's sometimes rather interesting. Church is big business. There's a lot of money in churches, and businesses target churches. In fact, I got a call this week. I get a lot of 800 number calls trying to sell things specifically to churches. It was on ice melt. You know,
you know, how big is your church? When we find out we're a small church, oh, well, he didn't even bother with us. No problem. Thank you. Goodbye. Why? Because it's about money. About money. Be surprised how many things in society are connected with churches, and specifically, if you go on the internet and you type in church issues, you find a lot of money and business stuff connected with that. Now, there's very few things that are in all four Gospels, but this is one of them. All four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all have clearing of the temple. Now, it's interesting, John chapter 2, it has right after his first miracle. The rest of them have right in the end in terms of the triumphal entry. Just after Jesus had his triumphal entry, that's where he cleaned out the temple. So they're 3 years apart about. Now, some people say it's a mistake of scripture and they should be together, which is interesting. It's like, I don't think, I think Jesus, it's one thing that triggered him to do something with churches. By the way, Jesus really got angry at church people, but he didn't get angry at the people that were outside the church that just didn't know any better. It's fascinating. He got angry with people that should have known better. It's an interesting thing. They should have known better. Now, Jesus went from Cana to Capernaum, which is about 79 miles or 85, depending on what your GPS you use, which route you go. But it was about that. It's about 100 miles, not quite, if you go a shorter route. So it's quite a ways. A lot of miles to walk. Now, we've talked about that before, how Jesus took a lot of time to walk. We miss out on that because we're usually driving. We try and drive, you know, at least the speed limit or faster than the speed limit. If you don't, your children get angry because you're not even going the speed limit. You know, that stuff happens. It's like, you know, go at least the speed limit, maybe a little bit over, maybe even the policeman won't catch you if you go fast in the right places. And anyhow, but there they had to walk. And so at the beginning of his earthly ministry, public ministry, he took time to walk, and he went up to the religious situation, religious things that he was dealing with. So verses 13 and 14, I call corruption with religion, and it talks about him going to the Jewish Passover there. He went up to Jerusalem, which topography is always up to Jerusalem. It's up, it's the highest point in Israel, except for Hermon, Mount Hermon. So it's a very high up, and so it always says going up to Jerusalem, and that's where he was going. Passover lamb, in chapter 1, they repeated, Jesus was told, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. It ties into the Old Testament. And by the way, that's why the Old Testament is so good. I know Cody mentioned that this morning. Is because in the Old Testament, in Exodus chapter 12, it talks about the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed so that they sprinkled the blood over the door so that the death angel didn't kill the firstborn. And so that's what it talks about. And that's what they were going up to celebrate. They celebrated that over and over because it was a deliverance from Egypt, which was oppression and slavery. And so that's the background to it. And the temple courts refer to the large courthouse, or courtyard, excuse me, the large courtyard. There were different courts. It was the court of the Gentiles. It surrounded the temple enclosure itself. It would be like if I say to you, it was sort of like the parking lot area. You know, people were there and then they'd come in, right? It's sort of that kind of idea. It was outside the actual inside part of it. The pilgrims were there from all over the world in that day, and they came and they traveled there, and then because they couldn't bring the animal sacrifices and they didn't have the right kind of money because they needed the right kind of money, the shekels, so they needed doves, sheep, cattle, fruit, wine, flour, and oil. Expensive stuff. It cost a lot of money. And so they were supposed to have a part of that. And the creative way that people had come up with that way is to get more money out of the people. So what could they do? They had to have the sacrifice, and they had to exchange their money into, it'd be like, well, you had to have U.S. currency. And what they did is, just like today, if you exchange your money, there's a certain percent the bank takes for the service. Well, what they were doing is they were increasing the percentage that you could get out of it. and they could jack the price up. It's sort of like going to a football game. I mean, how much does a hot dog cost in a football game, a professional football game, hot dog? Anybody been to a professional football game recently?
$6.
Can you believe $6? It's highway robbery, right? I can't, for a hot dog. Unbelievable.
It's worth when you get
real. Yeah, there you go. I like it. So they were making a lot of money. I tell you, football is big business, right? Well, so is church's big business. And so what they were doing is people said, oh, I want to do it. And so churches made up these laws. And so they got people's money. And I tell you, churches today can come up with all sorts of ways, too, to try and get money and try and get people's money out of us. So they try and come creative ways. And by the way, if you look at church history, you'll find churches that got in trouble for doing that. All sorts of ways that churches have tried to get more money out of people. And Jesus got angry with that. He got very angry at how people were doing that. They had to change the half shekel, which is a Jewish coin, and they had to get all these animals. The doves were for the very poor people. Now, the table that they had set up, these people that they were exchanging money, selling money, and they were sitting at tables exchanging money. These tables were for foreign exchange and larger denominations into smaller ones. So they're called money changers. Sometimes we call those banks today, but fortunately Turtle Lake has a couple banks that I think are honest and they're not trying to gouge you, at least most of the time, right? Okay, they're fair, okay? But there they weren't. They used religious setting and these travelers, because if you make people feel guilty, it's like, oh, they got to do this and they got to do that. Then they feel guilty. Then it's like, oh, so guilt motivates them to do these things and they get ripped off. And what could they do? Because they wanted to do spiritual things. It's like, oh, wow, what a corrupt, messed up. And by the way, these were people that called themselves God followers, right? It's terrible. Had to have the right money. Of course, that was a man-made rule. Yeah, have to have the right money. And then people took advantage of each other in terms of the middleman. Well, Jesus got very angry in verse 15 through 17. He made a whip and he drove out all the temple area, cattle, sheep, scattered the coins, money changers, and overturned the tables. He didn't attack the people. He attacked what they were doing. Anger was good because he said, this is corrupt and evil, as we're going to see. The issue is, how do you direct your anger? You need to direct it to something that's going to lead to a good end. The good end was that he was going to get rid of all this money stuff in the church. He wasn't going to get rid of the bad money stuff, but the good money stuff, he's going to get rid of the bad corruption that had happened. Malachi actually predicted the one, the Messiah, who would come suddenly to the temple to purify the religion of the nations. Malachi chapter 3, 1 through 3. He said, suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. Verse 3, he will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. He will purify the Levites and refine them like silver and gold. It was predicted of Malachi. Now, so I got a little fun question for you. Trivia question. How many of you knew that the purifying of the temple was a fulfillment of Scripture before this morning? How many of you knew that? I didn't have a clue. Did you know that? Good job. Excellent. Good job. Did you, Shaylee? I love it. Yeah, it's good. You're embarrassed, right? Congratulations. I didn't even know that. I don't know why. I just missed it all these years. The Bible always has something new, right? I didn't realize. That's what they say. There's so many fulfillments of Scripture. And if you don't know the Old Testament, you miss it, right? It's like, ah. So it's really amazing. So these people missed the prophecy that was fulfilled right in what they were doing. Jesus went and he cleaned it out and says, hey, you need to refine this place. Verse 16, he addressed specifically those who sold doves, and he said, get these out of here. How dare you turn my father's house into a market? He says, you missed the point of the father's house. His fathers remembered what is written, zeal for his house will consume me. The issue was not doves. The issue was not money. It was how they handled the doves and money. And he said, my father's house, which is a claim to divine connection, he was the divine son of God. He wasn't just a good prophet, a good teacher. He wasn't just a good person. And many people today say, Jesus is a good person. He had good things to say. It's like, no, we're talking the son of God, divine. And he claimed that. Either he's a liar, or he's a lunatic, or he is the son of God. Those are the only choices we have. Well, some here thought he was a lunatic, right? Then he applied the word of God and says, hey, don't you understand Psalm 69, verse 9, about the love, how he loved this father's house? And he says, you need to understand that zeal for my father's house will consume me. Now, this says something very important. Some people think that this church stuff is a God, is a human imagined organization. In other words, humans made it up. And they don't realize the divine handprint of God on what we're doing. Now, we mess it up as churches, and we do wrong things just like there. We just do a terrible job, but it doesn't negate the fact of it's God's divine assignment that you and I be involved in a collection of people to worship together. That's, we say, is church optional? Well, yeah, it's optional. I can attend or not attend or whatever. I can do whatever. It's like, I know, but this is, what we're doing together is God's assignment from him. Jesus said, I will build my, people are sleeping already. Jesus said to Peter, I will build my
house upon a rock.
That's right. Very good. I will build my church, and he's going to do it upon this rock. What we're doing today is God's stuff. It's his design. And some people say, church is some human organization. They mess it all up. I say, you're right. It's messed up, but it is not designed by humans. It's assigned by God. He said, my father's house. Sometimes I think we think this stuff is just whatever. It's like, no. This is God's stuff. This is divine stuff. It's my prayer. When you come to church, you don't come here and say, oh, yeah, I went to church. I heard some good music. We like the band. It's like, no, I met God. I met the living God today. There's a big difference. There's a big difference in coming to church. So I did my thing. Now I go home and do whatever I want. It's like, no. Today I met God in church. And I fellowshiped. And I did what God told me to do. He says, don't forsake doing it. Don't forsake. It's not just somehow some optional activity that you say, well, whatever, if I feel like it fits in. No. No. He says, no, this is my father's house. It's like, oh, wow. Jesus said, look, you've messed up because it's supposed to be, your focus is to be on the Father, and you've missed it. You've made it into a marketplace. Now, I've been criticized over the last 39 years of ministry because they say, how come you don't talk about money more? How many sermons have I ever preached since I've been here on money? None. Now, I'm not afraid to talk about money, but that's not the focus of church. If you go to a church business meeting and all they talk about is money, what's wrong with that? Well, it's like their focus is wrong. Well, now, praise God, we need to talk about money because we want to spend God's money carefully. And we've got people in place that carefully handle money, and it's open to anybody. It's not private. Some churches you go to, it's like, oh, this is private. You know, nobody knows what's happening with money. You know, it's like, what's happening? I don't know. Nobody knows. It's like, what do you mean? What do you mean? It's open. Anybody, if you're visiting with us, you can go to Doris, and it's all public except for she doesn't reveal who gives what. That's private business. But anything else, you can write who gives what. You can write every check is every check. She'll tell you. She can print it out for you. She can look. You can look at it. Carefully handled. So that's all right, but if that's what churches talk about, they miss the point. And pastors, we miss the point. I always said if we're doing God's work, you don't have to worry about the money. Why? Because the money will be there for God's work. I just replaced that one. That was a dangerous occupation, actually. What happens in the church when the lights go out, huh? Somebody didn't pay the bill this week. just kidding. No, she always pays the bill. Jesus said, this is my Father's house, and your focus is on the wrong thing. He had a zeal for this house, and I appreciate many of you who have a zeal for the house of God. You're deeply committed to the mission we're on. The mission is not money. The issue is not the building. The issue is meeting the Father, who is the Heavenly Father. And we have the privilege of focusing on that. They missed the point, verses 18. The Jews demanded him. So the Jews started talking. Said, oh, we want a miraculous sign. We want you to prove what authority. And of course, they were all messed up. They were into this authority business and who had power and all the politics of the church. They were into all that garbage. And Jesus said, I'm going to destroy the temple and I will raise it up again 3 days. They didn't have a clue. They were so tuned out. They were so focused on the wrong thing that they missed out on Jesus. After 3 days, when he was rose from the dead, verse 22, his disciples recall what he had said, and they believed the scriptures. And that's what we need to say. We want people to believe the scriptures. That's why when you come to church, I hope you know this is just not Steve's opinion. They come here and say, oh, yeah, Steve's opinion. It's like, no, we're studying the Holy Word of God. In fact, on your bulletin today, when you came in, right on the outside of it, it says, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. You know, when we study this book, this is just not a good storybook. This is just not some interesting stuff. This is the Word of God. This is the word. If prophecies are fulfilled, it's like, oh my, you know, what prophecies are being fulfilled right now? It's like, oh yeah, interesting conversation right in our lifetime. And understand, wow, the word of God is coming true. They missed out. They missed it. They wanted proof of authority. They wanted a miracle. Jesus just did the one at Cana of Galilee and then referred to the future one that was happening, but they were so messed up, they didn't even get it. They were not tuned into the Word of God. They didn't know the Word of God. Maybe they didn't know the prophecies. Some of us don't know the Word of God well enough to even know what it says, to even know the prophecy, to even know if it's true, but we somehow missed the point. The temple was an amazing one. It took 46 years. We're talking about a church makeover, and people say, wow, I hope it gets done in a few months. They had an amazing building, 46 years. 46 years. And you read about it, and it's amazing in structure and architecture, and wow, I mean, it's amazing. Jesus said, but the real issue is me and my dying for your sins so that you can have eternal life. That's the real issue he's talking about here. And so easy, we mess up. I wrote down here, are we keeping our focus? Yeah, I mean, we need to keep asking that. Are we keeping our focus as a church family? Do we need to talk about money? Yeah, Jesus wasn't against money, and Jesus had many principles to say, so it's not against, but it's like, that's not our focus. That's not what we're about. And by the way, I'm going to take a little side trip here. If we as families, that's our talk all the time, we miss our focus. The focus is not on money. The focus is on eternal things that last forever. And that needs to come into our personal lives. Some of us talk about investments, and that's fine. We need to talk about that stuff. God gives us responsibility, and the Bible's full of those kind of things about being careful and stuff. But the ultimate reason of why we work with money is for eternal things, that money that lasts forever. Jesus said, don't lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. And it's fun when you sit down as a family and say, how can we make money last forever? The market never goes down. You'll never lose your investment. And it lasts forever. And we have the privilege of keeping our focus on things that last forever. It's my prayer that we, as individuals and as a church family, are never a hindrance to the kingdom of God because of how we handle money. But people will say, there's something that happens in this church with money. That's amazing. And I see my money being changed forever. And so it's not a money thing, it's a forever thing. So we're going to have the group come up and sing again. And they're going to sing about the real purpose that we're here and what we're about. And it's not about money. It's about Jesus Christ and Him being Lord. And boy, it's good to be reminded of that. In the midst of all life that you and I are dealing with, jobs and yeah, things that go wrong, financial, whatever, and say, God, it is about you. And so I think we're having a few issues. Good old electronics, they get us, don't they? There we go. So, yeah, Christ is the one. Let's stand as we sing together.
There's no
for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need.
God, I pray that we would keep our focus. All of us struggle with that. Personally and as a church, God, I pray it would be about you. You're enough. You're what brings us hope. You're the one that brings us peace, gives us purpose. That's amazing. You're the one that gives us a reason to work and earn money and to spend it to your glory. I thank you for our youth. And the leaders of our youth, thank you for the amazing mission they're on to share Jesus. Thank you for the privilege of supporting their desire to go on a trip to help share Jesus and share the world that you are hope. God, I thank you for the privilege of supporting them and being a part of our food that follows. God, I thank you for the joy of sharing Jesus with our world, whether it's here in Turtle Lake and Mercer and Underwood or wherever you put us. Thank you, we can share it around the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.